You can tell you're watching a Wes Anderson film when everything looks like an animated painting. Each shot is so meticulously designed, if you pause in the middle, it would assume the aesthetics of an artwork. Like an illustration artist, every patch of color and screen direction is chosen with the same amount of care put into the script itself. Symmetry and color are the two things everyone associates with at the thought of a Wes Anderson film. But beyond mere aesthetics and what some would call an obsessive OCD are themes of nostalgia, youth, family, and at the heart and roots of it all, Anderson's personal history. Anderson's films are clearly influenced by his childhood. Growing up in a Texan family with two brothers, Anderson's father worked in advertising, and his mother was an archaeologist.
Ethelene became an archaeologist, and it
However, his parents divorced when he was only 8 years old.
Decade, he and his wife had three children, and then they separated.
Immediately, you notice how Anderson's personal life directly influences film The Royal Tenenbaums.
From characters, I work from my own experience.
Not only can you attribute Anderson's precise symmetry, carefully constructed scenes, and clean looks to his father's advertising career, in fact, he said himself that if he had not begun directing films, he would have become an architect. You can see Anderson's lingering nostalgia and themes of estranged family relations in most of his films, which also establishes tone of a light-hearted dark humor. His films are self-reflections of his childhood. The theme of nostalgia is blatantly obvious in Anderson's films. Nostalgia is not only seen through the settings of his film, but also through Anderson's homage to the French New Wave. His reference to many French New Wave directors are seen through his use of symmetrical and quirky shots to create a sense of fragmentation and disruption of narration. As you can see, the colors of Jean-Luc Godard, 1961, A Woman is a Woman, has clearly influenced Anderson's films. Anderson also emphasizes the theme of youth and innocence. A lack of a mother figure is common throughout Wes Anderson's film, as he focuses mainly on broken fatherhood that sews itself back together through the course of the film. With a love for pastel blues, pinks, reds, muted yellows, and washed-down browns, Wes Anderson is able to create specific aesthetic styles, moods, tones, and even emphasize his reoccurring themes. And in this, red and yellow plays a significant role. Anderson tells the story of problematic fatherhood, passion, and longing in red. The male characters wearing red in Anderson's film adopt a certain boyish enthusiasm and help emphasize the relationship of this character to the others. In The Royal Tenenbaums, red seemed to be a color of longing and insecurity. Chaz Tenenbaum has always worn a red Adidas tracksuit in his adulthood, supposedly since the death of his wife. Red shows a feeling of longing as Chaz laments over his loss by trying to keep his two sons as safe as possible with his insecure paranoia. Red also emphasizes him as an unsuccessful father figure and his hostile yet secretly longing relationship with his estranged father. The same longing and detached familyhood is shown here, where Margot's feelings were hurt by her adopted father's opinion.
What characters? There's a bunch of little kids there dressed up in animal costumes.
Good night.
And here, when Royal longs to bring his family back.
I thought I could win you back.
Red in the Grand Budapest Hotel also shows a similar concept. Look at the compositions in these two shots. And these. Notice the changes Anderson made to cinematography. In these shots, Zero is always positioned at secondary importance. But as the characters establish more trust and faith between each other, the two characters slowly become equals and share the composition. The color red also plays a significant role in this change. In this scene, Gustave and Zero, for the first time, breaks away from the relationship between a hotel concierge and a lobby boy and become almost a father-son or partner-in-crime relationship. Red establishes a similar sense of longing as Zero finally found familyhood after his parents died.
Say again?
Well, you see, my father was murdered.
Similarly, a sense of longing and insecurity can be seen in the elevator in Madame D's outfits, as she is a vulnerable woman who looks to Gustave for love and security. Another color Anderson likes to focus on and use in conjunction with his red is yellow. Yellow, in many of Wes Anderson's films, symbolizes hope and youth. The color suggests a beam of hope and playfulness in the insecurity suggested by the red. This contrast in tone offers a sense of dark humor,
what happened to your phone?
Which is also evidenced throughout Anderson's style.
Try to sew it back on?
Wasn't worth it.
Here's an example from The Royal Tenenbaums. A quirky yellow hue is contrasted with the sheer blue tones in Richie Tenenbaum's suicide scene, suggesting a sense of childish optimism. This is then brought to another bright yellow scene in which Richie and Margot confess their love for each other since they were children, hence the theme of youth. And here's Moonrise Kingdom, where the overarching theme of youth and love is expressed solely through the color scheme of brownish yellow. The pastel aesthetics of a perfect dollhouse is somewhat paired with somber contents. Innocence suffuses dark themes with a bright cover-up. In addition to his intended focus on family and fatherhood, he reveals to the viewers a piece of himself through his dark humors.
Did I hit the dog?
Yeah.
Is he dead?
Yeah.
Cinematography also plays a significant role in creating Anderson's signature moods and tones. Symmetry down the center of the frame, possibly inspired by Stanley Kubrick, along with the lateral tracking shots, create a very two-dimensional feeling to the film. His tracking shots not only tell the scope of the environment clearly, but accentuates his style with symmetry. Anderson always employs this camera movement in conjunction with the narrating voice and symmetry. While symmetry is naturally pleasing to the eye, the combined use of narration and lateral movements also gives the audience the pleasure of being the spectators of the situation, or the readers of the book.
Richie's best friend, Eli Cash, lived with his aunt in the building across the street. He was a regular fixture at family.
Which leads us to Anderson's unique story structures. He really takes the extra step to make us feel like we're reading a book. Not only does most of his film follow the hero's journey story structure, Anderson even uses special inserts within the film to emphasize a specific phase or chapter of the story. A connection to children's book is repeatedly made through repetition of books as an important element and the opening and closing scenes of some of his films. We all remember how Disney does this. And here Wes Anderson is drawing that parallel between his childhood experience and his longing imagination of youth. Wes Anderson's themes, use of colors, cinematography, and story structures are all very dependent on his early childhood experience. Without the loss of his own childhood, he would have never been able to express his aspiration to relive his youth in his film, and his style would not exist. He brings about a childlike absorption in the adult bittersweetness of the world. He is projecting a sort of fantasy in the form of a beautiful fairy tale.